While Sahar is setting up her her PowerPoint, I will do what I should do, and my job is to speak as little as possible and get out of the way so that we can listen to our very interesting panel this afternoon. But my name is John Ball, and I would like to welcome you on behalf of the Prince Al-Wali bin Talal Center for Muslim Christian Understanding, the Center for Contemporary Arab Studies here at Georgetown, and the Egyptian American Rule of Law Association, who are the three co-sponsors of this session this afternoon. And basically, we have three people who I think are probably the best prepared in sort of a grand region for looking at the question of Egypt's elections and the current status in Egypt and so on. And you can find a lot of their information. Our first speaker will be Sahar Aziz, who has just recently joined the faculty of Texas Wesleyan University School of Law. She has been here in DC doing a variety of things. She has worked in areas that make her one of the most informed legal experts on contemporary election and politics and so on in Egypt. We have my colleague Samer Shahata, who is here at the center, who is similarly disposed but less legal and more anthropological and sociological and political. He is assistant professor of Arab politics here at the CCAS. And then we have Michelle Dunn, who I was talking with her. She has now assumed a really interesting new job as the founding director. I mean, you should make use of that, the founding director of the Atlantic Council's Rafiq Hariri Center for the Middle East. I was talking with her. I will miss being able to read what she used to write relatively regularly for Carnegie, but she promises me that she will continue to write. So we've got what should we say, the best show in town. Our ground rules are that they're each going to talk for about 15 minutes, and then that will leave us time for discussion and questioning. And so without further ado, let me turn it over to Sahar.
Okay. Thank you so much. It's good to be back in D.C. It's good to see friendly faces and familiar faces, including Khalil Al-Gindi, who is one of our board members at the Egyptian American Rule of Law Association. And I should, you know, the credit, anything I do that is informed by, or that is that shows some expertise on Egyptian law is really a credit and a tribute to the Egyptian American Rule of Law Association, which is about 40 Egyptian American lawyers working together as a brain trust to support rule of law reforms in Egypt as we speak. So, this is where my technological savviness ends. There we go. Okay, so I figured I would start with the conclusions first, or kind of my findings is maybe what I should say. This is based on a law review article that's going to be published in the Fordham International Law Journal in August, and it's based on some very tedious and difficult research. Egyptian law is not easy to research, especially in English, and trying to find translations. But these are kind of my main findings of fact. First, the amendments to election laws after the revolution are insufficient. They're definitely in the right direction, but more reforms are needed, and I'll explain why. Second, one thing that has happened, as a matter of fact, is that the Higher Elections Commission, which supervises the Shura Council and People's Assembly, the parliamentary elections, and the Presidential Election Commission have now been transformed into judicial bodies. As opposed to being quasi-judicial where they have political appointments. The quota for women has been eliminated, which has unfortunately created some, in my opinion, adverse impact on women and women, Egyptian women's representation in parliament. And Egyptian cops remain inadequately represented. This isn't much of a change from before the revolution, but I think it's something that we have to talk about, particularly if we're going to talk about women. I think we have to talk about religious minorities as well. Okay, so what are my recommendations? Well, first, I think that it's at least worth a discussion. I'm not sure, I'm not as confident with this recommendation, the first one of whether we should have the HEC and the PEC, the Higher Election Commission and the Presidential Election Commission, to be an independent election commission, which is much more of the norm, and particularly in developing countries, as opposed to a judicially run entity. And it's worth a conversation. Now, I'll go into more detail about why that's a lot more complicated than it sounds, which is why I'm a bit ambivalent about it. Second, there needs to be a judicial appeals process. There is not an appeals process in place for the PEC and HEC, primarily because they're run by judges. And the PEC, which I'll go into in some details, there's actually a legal problem because it was put into the interim constitutional declaration without much thought. And as far as addressing the female representation and the religious minority representation, I think Egypt would be well served following Tunisia's model, which is where they require that every other candidate on a party list is a woman. And that is mandatory. In Egypt, the only requirement is that one woman within the list, and I'll explain the closed party list in a minute, one has to be a woman. She ends up being at the bottom, and it's really a meaningless requirement. And then this is my own recommendation, and I look forward to critiques of it, is I've been thinking, you know, how do you get more Coptic representation? And I think that perhaps kind of like the gender ordering, you could have it where in the districts where you have at least 10% of the general population is Coptic, that you would require parties to put one Coptic candidate in the top three slots. And that might be a better solution, and I'll talk why I don't think a quota is a good idea. Okay, so that is just to give you a framework of what I found in my conclusions. Now we get into the really boring nitty-gritty election law. And the reason why I'm using a PowerPoint is because there's no way I can hold your attention on this dry legal stuff for 15 minutes. These are the laws that govern elections in Egypt. You've got two constitutional amendment or articles that, now these are of the 1971 constitution, which has been suspended. And then you've got four laws, each one, as you can see, governs, and these laws are not just governing elections, there's just articles within those laws. And then you have some military decrees that have been issued post-revolution that in effect amend those other laws, okay? Okay, so obviously when you talk about the law, you gotta talk about the constitution. Egypt is in a bit of a bizarre situation right now because it has an interim constitutional declaration that I don't know what percentage of it, one could say 70-80% of it was really unilaterally decreed by the military. There is a bit of a spin about it, that it's based on a referendum. But the referendum which took place in March 13, 2011, right after the revolution was over, was very limited in scope and really dealt more with when should Egypt have parliamentary elections, before or after they go into a very thorough constitutional drafting phase. And so, as you can see, 77% of the vote of the voters, of the eligible voters, excuse me, of the voters who turned out, voted yes, and 23% voted no, and there was a 41% voter turnout, which was really high for Egypt. You know, we're talking, I think, historically maybe 10%. And then after that, they realized that there was this big debate about, but what are we going to do with everything else in the Constitution? We amended some articles through this referendum, and so the military kind of, I think a lot of it, I take the more not sinister approach, I take the more incompetency approach to it, that I think they were just, they're not lawyers, they're not legal experts, everything was happening very rushed. So they said, okay, we'll just have this interim declaration. And the 39 and 76, which as you can see are part of Egypt's election laws, were adopted. And then they amended Article 88, which that was what transformed the HEC and the PEC into judicial bodies. Okay, so before the election, and you can see facially why it's problematic. And you have to remember the backdrop. The National Democratic Party, which was Mubarak's party, pretty much ran the government and dominated the government and established rules to make sure that their dominance in politics would continue. The Minister of Interior chaired it. Three deputy heads of the Supreme Court of Cassation were on it. Six impartial public figures, take that with a grain of salt, what impartial means. They were supposed to not have any affiliation with any political party, but I think in reality that wasn't usually the case. Four of them were chosen by the parliament, People's Assembly, two chosen by the Shura Council, and then three of those six had to be former members of the judiciary. So I think that was an attempt to be a little bit more objective. Then there was the technical secretariat that was chaired by a political appointee by the Minister of Interior, and they reviewed the nomination applications and they vetted the candidates for parliament. So they were the gatekeepers. So there's a lot of power in the AGC of who was going to get to play. Okay, so after the revolution, the military issued decrees 46 and 110 of 2011, and that essentially amended Law 73 of 1956. And that's where you have the transition into a judicial body. They prohibited parliamentary appointments, they made the president of the Cairo Court of Appeals the chair, and then these are the other members. They're all, as you can see, judges. They abolished the technical secretariat and replaced it with a judicially run general secretariat. So facially, this seems like a positive move, at least, you know, it's all relative to where you were to where you were going. And now what is its mandate? So it is supposed to promulgate rules for elections monitoring by Egyptians and international observers, so it recognizes the role of international observers and that they should be there. Now, in the last elections, I don't know if that was implemented as well. There were many international observers that wanted to be there, but the judges actually weren't open to it as much as we expected. They appoint members and secretaries of the general election polling and counting committees. These are the people in every governorate that are actually implementing the election, so they're supervising those committees. Same thing with voter lists, making sure that, you know, who's actually eligible has really fit the criteria. This is also important, rules for regulation of electoral campaigning, including equal time rules for TV and advertising, so all that also matters in whether a party has an advantage. And then the symbols on the lists. And then they declare the results, which is obviously the most important part of the elections, and then the runoffs. Okay, so this is really meant to start the conversation, and I'm very interested in hearing feedback, because this is my next area of research, is should the Higher Elections Committee be a judicial body? Pros, Egyptians trust judges relative to non-judges. So part of it is cultural, historical. Anything, you know, it's a little bizarre, but they have a lot of trust in judges compared to the executive branch and compared to, I mean, you tell someone, oh, it's an independent commission, and they kind of laugh at you. They're like, yeah, independent, right? It's, nothing's really independent. But somehow, I guess because the judges have been able to create quasi-independence in a very difficult political context. And then, so you've got this politicization. The cons, you compromise the judicial independence, and I've spoken to some Egyptian judges. They do not want the AGC and the PC to be judicially run, because they feel then they become corrupted and tainted. What they want is to judicially review decisions by the PEC and AGC that is not judicially run. But they feel now that they're becoming entangled in what they call dirty politics, because politics is dirty. It's politics. And they don't want to be part of the political creation system. And then again, you've got a problem with the appeals process, because putting aside the fact that it's prohibited by law right now, which could be fixed theoretically, but who do you appeal to? You appeal to the same judges that made the decision, and so it creates a little bit of a problem. Okay, People's Assembly, just quickly, these are just some facts for you to know. It changed from 518 to 508. The quota was removed. It uses a mixed electoral system, which is a proportional party system, is where you go and you vote. There's a closed list, means you vote for that list. You don't vote for candidates. You vote for the party. And then when you vote for the party, however many number of votes they get depends on how many seats they get. So if they get two seats, then the first two named on their party get it. If they get three seats, they get three, et cetera. So you as a candidate, it's very important where you're listed on the list. If I'm on a party list and I'm last, that means I probably won't get a seat, unless that party just takes every seat in the entire district. And then independent candidate, that's the winner take all. That's the system we know here in America. So, you know, you vote for that particular individual. And 10 of them are appointed, and then you have this very convoluted and provincial and outdated farmer worker quota. 50% of the People's Assembly has to be a farmer or worker. There's always fighting about how that's defined. People are exploiting the definition. I go buy some tracts of land and say, hey, I'm a farmer. Okay, I want to be under that, because it's easier to get elected in. It's a guaranteed 50%. And then this just tells you kind of the point of proportional party representation. You shift the focus from individual candidates to political parties and their platforms. Some people have said that's a good thing in places like Egypt, because then it could force parties to talk about their platforms instead of just be personality-driven and charisma-driven, and people who can't, what are they going to deliver? And again, the ordering, it determines the outcome. And just to give you, this seat allocation is really important. This was something that people criticized the NDP for. Before the revolution, if your party didn't get at least 8% of the votes cast nationally, you didn't even have a right to get a seat in parliament. And they, NDP was accused at least of doing that on purpose to keep out minority parties and new parties. Now it's only 0.5%. That's essentially the minimum threshold for your party to even have a right to have a seat. Okay, and I won't go over, this is just what we know. The only thing worth noting is the Muslim Brotherhood usually use the independent candidate system to get its people in. They wouldn't openly say they were Muslim Brotherhood, but people pretty much knew because they were banned as a party. The Shura Council, the thing to note here is that they have no authority to pass legislation. A lot of people are calling for them to be complete, to just be abolished. They're not what you would think of as the Senate here, where they also legislate and they're supposed to kind of keep in check the more unwieldy and riffraff of the lower house. So that's not what they do. But they do have a few things that are pretty powerful. They have the authority to grant licenses to new political parties, which they used to, it was run by the NDP. It was pretty much an NDP entity before the revolution. They also control the Higher Press Council, which regulates the media. So they would manipulate that regulation authority to keep
now,
criticism.
Kevin said that from time to time the lights go off.
Just move around a lot.
We are probably in, it's in Egypt, right?
Yeah. The power went out.
The power went out.
So as long as the presentation's right. And then minimal changes afterwards. Okay. Couple of other things. So this is before the revolution. Good luck trying to run for president. You need 250 written endorsements from members of parliament and local officials, at least 65 from the People's Assembly, at least 25 from the Shura Council, and at least 10 from every local council in at least 14 governorates. It was nearly impossible. There was one other way, which was how Ayman Noor got on and some of the others, is if you had a political party with at least one seat in parliament and you were a member of the senior board of that party. So after the revolution, they got a decree number 12 of 2012, made it a little more difficult to run, and that was, I think, aimed more at Baradei and people who were from the diaspora, so people like myself, for example, couldn't go and say, oh, I want to run for president, putting aside that I'm a female, which is the biggest disadvantage. But so no dual citizenship, parents can't have dual citizenship, spouse has to be an Egyptian citizen. And then as far as how to get on the ballot, it's a lot, as you can see, a lot lower threshold. Written endorsement from at least 30 members of parliament or signatures of 30,000 eligible votes from 15 governorates. That's doable, and you have to just get it notarized. And there's over 500 applications right now to be president, so it's going to be really interesting. Okay. The only thing to note here with the presidential elections, again, is there is no right to appeal, and the reason is because it's in the institutional interim constitutional declaration. So there's actually a constitutional crisis. You can't just say, oh, parliament, why don't you just pass a new law and allow an appeal? Well, but it's in the constitution. I can't pass a law that violates the constitution. So there's a lot of, and keep your, this is something to watch out for in June. There's a lot of anxiety about this because if the PEC, if there's some kind of controversy around a PEC decision, things are not going to be good. Okay. Now these are my recommendations, which I've already went through, and I will be very quick. Look at the number of women. Women have already been dismally unrepresented in Egyptian politics and the parliament. So the quota was passed in 2010. It was supposed to be for only two terms. It was a way to kind of boost it and normalize having women in parliament, and then hopefully it would become, you know, more of a cultural practice. That's mine. It's so embarrassing. So then 8% were in 2007 and 12.7% in 2010. And that's based on the quota.
I think that's yours, not mine,
yeah.
Right?
I'm sorry about that. In 2012, which is just after the revolution, only 12 women in the People's Assembly. 8 elected. I believe it's 4 appointed. Someone might correct me because I've been trying to find out how many were appointed. But look at the difference. Look at Tunisia. You got 22%. Because of the gender ordering. So obviously it's making a difference. And for those who are like, oh, that's not fair, this is gonna create an all-woman, or even a 50%, God forbid, parliament, which represents the population, it doesn't. It just, does about, you know, 30%. These are the Coptic representations in 2005, that's supposed to be 2005. Five were elected, one was appointed, so it's already pretty low. In 2010, they actually did a little better. Eight elected, five appointed is the People's Assembly. And then again, this is kind of my recommendation is to try to deal with that. And then just finally, these are more generic recommendations. The PEC and the HEC, their deliberations are not transparent. There's actually, for the HEC, you have a law that says it's mandated that it's secret. In other countries, their deliberations and their meetings are public. Observers can come, citizens can come. It's kind of like a local council, city council meeting. It's all very open to the public. So that, I think, should be changed. Obviously, we need an appeals process, which legally is a lot more complicated. And then at least have a debate about whether it's feasible in Egypt, and if it is, when, and because it is more complicated. The judges now need to be trained, because for better or worse, the judges are in it. And they're pretty much the entire election monitoring system at this point. And a lot of them don't really know what they're doing, and rightfully so. So somebody needs to train them. And then the educating the voters, which is a generic recommendation, but the reason why it's important is the HEC used to be mandated to do that. I don't know if they did a good job of it, but they were legally mandated to educate voters and raise awareness and tell voters their rights. That has been taken away from them post-revolution, so there is no government entity that does it. That begs the question, should the government be doing that in the first place? Because Egyptian government isn't known for being the most effective bureaucracy. But if you want to keep the voter turnout high after the post-revolution kind of euphoria, you've got to keep educating the voters. Okay, and that's it. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much. And now we turn it over to Samer.
Great, thank you.
Let's see if I can get this right. Okay, so I have been charged in the Division of Labor here today to speak about the presidential candidates. And before I do that, and that kind of leaves me from the burden of saying anything profound or insightful, because I'm just going to speak to you about the different presidential candidates, what they represent, maybe their bases of support, and so on. But before I do that, let me just say a couple of things. The first thing is that, you know, and this is somewhat obvious, but there is some important significance of this. This is the first time that Egypt is going to have anything possibly approaching an election, a presidential election with integrity. And what that means is that this is a new phenomenon. And the previous experiences that Egypt has had with presidential elections, namely the 2005 election, after the Article 76 being amended to allow multi-candidate presidential elections, because before that, you'll remember, it was only a referendum system, yes or no. What that means is that that doesn't serve as any kind of a previous model from which we can draw conclusions about the way these elections might turn out. You'll remember in 2005, there were two questions that people asked about those elections. Not who was going to win. We knew who was going to win. The two questions that people asked about those elections was, who's going to come in second? And secondly, what is voter participation or turnout going to be as a measure of how serious Egyptians took those elections? Because we knew that it was a charade to some extent. That's the first point. The second point is, I would argue that even the parliamentary elections that we experienced in Egypt in November, December, and then if you count the Shura Council elections into 2012, aren't necessarily an exact or automatic indicator of what the presidential elections are going to be. Those of us who study elections in authoritarian regimes and elections in Egypt in particular, particularly parliamentary or legislative elections, know that largely people vote in those elections not on the basis of ideology, not on the basis of political platforms, but on the basis of what the candidate can deliver to voters. And I don't mean what the candidate can deliver to voters in their district, right? No, what the candidate can deliver to you as a voter. Can he get you a job, or can, less likely, she get you a job? Can the candidate, the member of parliament, get your mother-in-law health care that's needed that you can't afford, and so on? And so then what I would argue is that the the, you know, better than expected by many performance of Islamist candidates, the Muslim Brotherhood with 43% of parliament and the Salafi coalition with about 25% of parliament, isn't an exact indication of how well a presidential candidate will be who has the support of Islamist parties. Simple point. I think there's no question that, you know, if the Muslim Brotherhood nominates someone or who they support and so on, as well as the different Salafi parties, that'll have some influence. But it's not by any means guaranteed that the next president of Egypt will be someone who is an Islamist or has the support of Islamist parties uniformly. Okay. Just that. The second thing I want to say is, as Sahar has said, there has been some serious criticisms of the presidential election process. The possibility that the elections might be forged or fraudulent has been brought up. There's been serious criticism of Article 28 in the Constitutional Declaration promulgated on March 30th that does not allow any kind of appeal of the rulings of the High Presidential Election Commission. Of course, who's headed by the head of the Supreme Constitutional Court, who was the Mubarak appointee from 2009 and has a dubious history of managing fraudulent elections in the past and so on. So there is some concern. And in fact, just yesterday or the day before, I can't remember, the Freedom and Justice Party or the Muslim Brotherhood made a statement that basically indicates their concern about the possibility of the elections being less than free and fair. And in fact, that was met by almost an immediate response by the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces and so on. Okay. The last thing I'll say before I get into the different presidential candidates is that I was in Egypt in early March, and it was at that time that there was talk of, now I think no longer the case, of a consensus candidate, right? Of someone being put forward to the population who would appease or have the support of both the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces as well as the Muslim Brotherhood, and maybe some general appeal among the population at large. And the individual who was put forward, it was believed, because his name was brought up and there was a great deal of attention around his potential nomination, was someone named Mansour Hassan, who was a minister of information under the Sadat regime, who has some degree of respect and validity among segments of the population, who was appointed in December, I think it was, as the head of the advisory council by the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, and so on. Now, he has recently withdrawn his candidacy, so that, you know, goes out the window. Okay. Moving on to the presidential elections and the candidates, just a couple things to say before I go through the list of candidates who I think are A-level candidates as opposed to the B-level candidates, and then the others who have expressed their desire, the hundreds who have expressed their desire, but really have no chance whatsoever to meet even the much more reasonable necessary requirements to put their names on the ballots that Sahar has mentioned and so on. The first is, of course, all elections are, or many elections, I should say, including in the United States, less so in England, I think, are carnivalesque, right? And that's certainly the case with regard to Egypt. Big shows, big productions, all kinds of rumors, tremendous excitement, and so on. I would just remind you that Egypt's carnivalesque presidential elections are occurring amidst the backdrop of some uncertainty about the transition process, less than complete confidence in the mechanism and the institutions that have been put in place that are supposed to produce a presidential candidate. I thought I got rid of this. And so on. In addition to the serious issues that Egypt is dealing with, having to do with the economic situation in the country, the deteriorated security situation, at least perceived deteriorated, well, deteriorated security situation. It's a question of how deteriorated and so on. Okay, so getting to the presidential candidates, I would say that we can divide the presidential candidates into maybe, well, multiple ways, but one way would be three different groups. Those who have a serious possibility of actually making it as president, kind of then B-list candidates who are known across the country and have an experience in politics, and then, of course, the others, you know, the hundreds of others who have expressed interest but really have no chance whatsoever. Another way to differentiate or separate the candidates would be, and this is not necessarily the most effective way, liberal, in some cases, pseudo-liberal candidates and Islamist candidates. But I'm not going to proceed in that way. I'm going to proceed in the order of candidates that have a potential shot of making it, as well as maybe the B-list candidates. Okay, number one, of course, we have here, let me see, I'm supposed to do what, slideshow or something? Slideshow, I think. Okay, we've got Amr Moussa, the most well-known, and I'm not going to spend too much time on Amr Moussa. I'll say that there are five A-list candidates, just very briefly so you know from the very beginning. Amr Moussa, Ahmed Shafiq, Abdelmenem Abul Futuh, Muhammad Salim Al-Awa, and Hazem Abu Ismail. I'll go through them very quickly. Amr Moussa, I'm not going to spend that much time on because many of you know Amr Moussa, Egypt's former foreign minister between 1991 and 2001. Before that, he was Egypt's representative to the United Nations. He held the post of Egypt's ambassador to both Switzerland as well as India. Of course, became quite famous in around 2000-2001 when Shaban Abdul-Rahim, the kind of folk popular singer, wrote the song I Hate Israel and Abakr Israel Bahib Amr Moussa and I Love Amr Moussa and so on, because of Amr Moussa's very forceful statements on the question of Palestine, Palestinian rights, perceived to be standing up to Israel and so on. And in fact, it was widely rumored at the time that Amr Moussa's transfer to the position of Secretary General of the Arab League, which he held from 2001 until he resigned recently to run for president, was because his standing among the Egyptian public was rising to the point that it actually threatened Mr. Mubarak, and that Mr. Mubarak wanted to eliminate him as a potential rival, removing him from the foreign ministry, and basically, we say, putting him on the shelf, in Arabic, of this less than significant Secretary General of the Arab League position. Okay, his basis of support, as it were. Tremendous name recognition. There's no question he is well-spoken, has a great deal of charisma. As I said, he's known for his forceful positions on Palestine. He was very much opposed to the Iraq War and U.S. policy with regard to the Iraq War in the Middle East generally, champions an independent Egyptian foreign policy, and so on. Now, unfortunately, for those of us who are interested in democratization, rule of law, real change in Egypt, I would argue that he doesn't represent any of those things, and he certainly doesn't represent liberalism either. You'll remember, he was definitely a part of the Mubarak regime. He was one of the nice faces of the Mubarak regime, but nevertheless a part of the Mubarak regime, who never in that period seemed to question or criticize Mr. Mubarak, never highlighted corruption or any of that matter. And in fact, he was sent, and there's some debate about this, he was sent during the protest to Tahrir Square. Arab League building is right there close to Tahrir Square. And there is a different understandings or different interpretations of why he was sent. He says he went down to Tahrir Square to support the revolutionaries. I was in Egypt in March after the revolution at an event in Cairo, with thousands of people crammed together to hear Amr Moussa speak. And as soon as Amr Moussa finished delivering his remarks, a young woman raised her hand and basically said, "You came to Tahrir by orders of the president to tell us to go home, and we're never going to forget that." And the point I'm making here is that he really represents a non-revolutionary, mainstream part of the establishment elements and so on. And I think he's somebody that the Supreme Council, the military, could potentially do business with. Opposed very much by revolutionaries, by liberals, by Democrats, and by Islamists, as it were. Okay. Then, of course, we have Ahmed Shafiq, who you will remember as Egypt's prime minister very briefly during the last days of the Mubarak regime. Forgot to mention Amr Moussa is 74 years old. Ahmed Shafiq is 70 years old. He's a graduate of the Egyptian Air Force Academy, Air Force pilot. I'm okay. He was Minister of Civil Aviation from 2002 until 2011. He was named prime minister on January 29th. During the last week or so of Mubarak's presidency, and then, of course, left that office in March of this year. If we could no longer change that, that would be great. You just leave it like this or keep the lights on, I'd appreciate it. He is thought to have or potentially have the support of the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, right? Because he is a former military man, an Air Force pilot, also in a way is a member of the Ancien Régime, hated by revolutionaries. He mocked them during the revolution, saying that most Egyptians aren't in Tahrir, they're at home, and so on. And so he represents, in some respects, I would say, the Ancien Régime, military interests, the security state, counter-revolution. And then we have third Abdelmenem Abdel-Fattah, who is 60 years old, a member of the Muslim Brotherhood for decades, a student leader in the 1970s, formerly the president of the medical students in Cairo, then president of Cairo University in the early 1970s, famous because he had once a confrontation with, that was, I think, either televised or on the radio, televised probably, with President Sadat, in which he held his ground when he was a young man and so on. A member of the Muslim Brotherhood Shura Council up until 2009, in which he didn't win re-election at that point to the Shura Council, and believed to be a moderate, progressive member of the Brotherhood, part of the Wasatiyya, or the centrist movement, in Islamist thinking that you can read about in Raymond Baker's Islam Without Fear. He recently got into trouble with the Brotherhood because in May of 2011, he announced that he was going to run, very much supported by youth members, of younger members of the Muslim Brotherhood. He was going to run for a presidency after the Brotherhood declared that they would not be putting forward a candidate and disallowing anybody of their membership from running for president. When he declared he was going to run, he was expelled from the organization. He's well-spoken, he's charismatic, as I said, he's quite popular among the Muslim Brotherhood youth, and this is what is most interesting in many ways about Abdelmenem Abdel-Fattah, is that now that Mohammed al-Baradei is no longer in the race, I would argue that young revolutionaries, people who genuinely believe in democracy, even liberals and so on, see in Abdelmenem Abdel-Fattah the best chance, including many Coptic Christians, the best chance of genuine, substantive, thorough reform of the Egyptian state and society in a democratic manner. Many people who previously supported al-Baradei, including my parents, for example, very liberal, are now, who would never think of necessarily supporting an Islamist candidate, think that Abdelmenem Abdel-Fattah represents the best chance for Egypt, as it were. Okay, the next candidate is Mohammed Salim Al-Awa, 70 years old. Mohammed Salim Al-Awa is an Islamist thinker and writer, a legal scholar and so on, graduate of Alexandria University, went to London to pursue a PhD at the School of Oriental and African Studies in the 1970s. Highly regarded thinker, very known for championing the cause of some opposition groups under the Mubarak regime in a kind of moderate manner. He was the lawyer of the Wasat Party, Abu Ayla al-Mahdi's party, break off from the Muslim Brotherhood in the mid-1990s, attempting to get them in front of the courts, legal status and legal recognition, as it were. Mohammed Salim Al-Awa, over the last several years, has put his foot in his mouth and possibly revealed his anti-liberal feelings to some extent with regard to a number of statements he made having to do with Copts in Egypt, Coptic Christians, claiming that in a number of churches the Copts have weapons and are quite ready to engage in violence against their Muslim countrymen and so on. Also, it's believed that he has good relations with the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces. The next gentleman is Hazem Abu Ismail, here, 50 years old, son of a very prominent Azhari Sheikh, Salah Abu Ismail, also who was a member of the Muslim Brotherhood. Hazem Abu Ismail has an ambiguous relationship with the Muslim Brotherhood. He ran on the Muslim Brotherhood ticket at least in 2005, I remember, maybe in 2000, in the Du'i neighborhood of Cairo. And in fact, I was there when it was announced that he won those elections in 2005 against a regime stalwart, Emel Osman, a kind of dinosaur of the Mubarak regime, who held the post of Ministry of now it's called Social Solidarity. It was called at the time Social Affairs, forever. And after it was announced that he won, and after it was printed in the papers, and Amal Osman happened to be a personal friend of Suzanne Mubarak, the regime changed the election results and he mysteriously lost. He's a Salafi. But he is a Salafi unlike many of the Egyptian Salafis in that he supported the revolution, he believed in political participation. As you know, the Salafis rejected political participation in formal politics, rejected demonstrations, rejected in opposition to the state up until really the middle of the revolution, as it were. He's also been, unlike many of the Salafis, quite confrontational with the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, denouncing them, denouncing their practices, calling for civilian control of the military, has been to Tahrir on a number of occasions, and so on. Now, that's really it with regard to the serious contenders. How many, do I have a minute left or zero?
A minute,
okay. That's really left
for
in terms
500
of-
500 other candidates.
The serious, for the other candidates. The B-list candidates quickly are Hamdine Sabahi, founder of the Karama or Dignity Party, populist, charismatic individual who I think he's from Kafr Sheikh maybe. He was a former Arab Nasserist, broke off from that party, founded this populist Arab Nasserist socialist party, won a parliamentary seat in 2005. We have also Hisham el-Bastawisi, a member of the appellate court in Cairo, became famous in 2005 and 2006 because him, along with Ahmed Mekki, first called or criticized the election fraud that took place in those elections, and then as a result of that was punished by the Mubarak regime and brought in front of a disciplinary court to censor him. And in fact, I was there in May, and there were demonstrations all across Cairo and many places across the country. This was the period where the judges were trying to push forward judicial independence. Hisham el-Bastawisi became nationally known, not charismatic, but a serious legal scholar, doesn't really have a chance, as it were. Boutaina Kamel, former TV anchor, TV personality, advocate for democracy, feminism. She's been supporting Samira Ibrahim in the virginity test case. She was on January 25. She was in Tahrir very much with the revolutionaries, a great deal of integrity. Unfortunately, I don't think she has a feminist. Unfortunately, I don't think she has too much of a chance also. Khaled Ali, a young labor activist, labor lawyer, 40 years old. He heads the Egyptian Center for Economic and Social Rights. He also doesn't have too much of a chance. Just the last thing I'll say, and I promise I'll finish here, just a couple of interesting dynamics with regard to the presidential elections. The first question is, will the Muslim Brotherhood run a candidate, right? Previously, the Brotherhood had said they weren't going to run a candidate, and that's why, in fact, they dismissed Abdelmanap Abu Futuh. Over the last few days, there has been speculation that the Brotherhood might run a candidate. Interesting to see how that will play out. I think the Brotherhood will not run a candidate, and that is because the idea that the Brotherhood would run a candidate and then that candidate potentially lose would be incredibly problematic for an organization and its image, which puts forward this powerful, almost not invincible, but incredibly, and so on. The second thing is, this is two rounds of voting, most likely, right? You have to get 50% plus one. That's an interesting dynamic because it's unlikely that any of these candidates is going to get 50% plus one in the first round of voting. So that means that we're likely to see the top two contenders, whoever they might be. People are saying Amr Musa, maybe Amr Musa Abdelmanap Abu Futuh, depending on how the Islamists vote. That's another major dynamic, right? Or people, and so on. Will they vote for Muhammad Salim al-Awa? Will they vote for Abdelmanap Abu Futuh? Will they vote for Hazm Abu Ismail? And then the last thing I'll say is simply alliances and vice presidents. There has been talk among a number of these candidates of getting someone as their vice president the way that happens in this country and so on to try to increase their base of support. I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. I don't have a PowerPoint, so I'm going to have to dazzle you with my fascinating talk, or you're all going to fall asleep. It falls to me to kind of make some observations about looking ahead to this presidential election in Egypt, and what does it mean, and what kind of a difference is it going to make? So first of all, at this point, we're pretty sure that a presidential election will take place. I mean, the planning is underway, the dates are set, and so forth. There are still things that could interfere with that. Samer referred to the very serious economic situation in Egypt, and that is something that I'm watching closely. There is a looming economic crisis in Egypt that could lead to, it already is leading to gasoline shortages, could lead to food shortages, could lead to a collapse of the value of the Egyptian pound and therefore to rapid inflation. And these kind of things could have political repercussions. So I want to kind of flag that for you as something to keep in your peripheral vision as you study the politics of Egypt, because we've been hearing recently the Brotherhood or the Freedom and Justice Party deputies in the parliament have been, and the Brotherhood leadership itself has been very, very critical of the current cabinet in Egypt, specifically partly because of the economic situation, because of economic mismanagement. And they've been accusing the current government that they are allowing the situation to, you know, sort of spiral down toward an economic crisis, which would happen just about as things are turned over from the military leadership to a civilian leadership. And they kind of don't want to be left holding the bag. So this is something to keep in mind. So we're pretty sure this presidential election will take place, but there could be things that could intervene. And so then the presidential election itself and the inauguration of a president would then constitute the handing over of power from the SCAF, the Supreme Council of the Armed Forces, back to a civilian body. They handed over legislative power after the parliament was elected and was seated. But they still hold executive power. They still hold the power of the president and the power to appoint the cabinet and so forth. So that's, you know, one of the things. Now, what else? There are things that we know and there are things that we don't know about this presidential election. As I said, we're pretty sure it's going to take place. Also, I would say in terms of what's the political import of this going to be, we know that there is a trend afoot. In fact, I would call it a mega trend across this region of a reapportioning of political power inside of systems away from the executive branch and toward the legislative branches of government. One of the things that has characterized Arab political systems for a long time is the overwhelming power of the executive branch of government as opposed to legislative and judicial branches, which in most countries exist, but have not had a whole lot of power. So we're definitely seeing that shift. And there has been a kind of consensus in Egypt that as they move toward writing a new constitution, as Saher was alluding to, that there will be some powers that move away from the executive branch, away from the president, and toward the legislature. In very rough terms, people are thinking in terms of the president having more control in foreign affairs and national security and less in domestic affairs. But I think all of that is very much yet to be sorted out. And even, you know, I mean, historically, the Brotherhood in Egypt was in favor of a wholesale change to a parliamentary system where, you know, the president would be purely a ceremonial figure and that the prime minister and the government would arise out of the elected parliament. The Brotherhood moved away from that just very recently, you know, just over the last year or two. And now are saying that they support this sort of semi-presidential system, a president with some power but less than he has had in the past. This also raises a lot of questions about the government or the cabinet in the future. Up till now, the cabinet in Egypt, as sort of is the case in the United States, was really appointed by the president, and the president had his choice of whom he wanted in the cabinet. And the cabinet really did not have much of a relationship with the parliament, or to put it another way, the parliament didn't have a lot of power over the cabinet. But I think we see that shifting. With the new parliament that's been elected in Egypt, there is a they're assertive, and they are asserting already that in the future, the cabinet should have a different kind of relationship with the parliament. And there are a number of different ideas out on the table. Should the members of the cabinet represent different political forces that are in the parliament? Should the parliament have the ability to vote confidence or no confidence in the prime minister and individual ministers? There are a lot of models out there, but I think this kind of thing is very much under discussion. And I would expect that in the future, the parliament is going to have more leverage over the cabinet than they've had in the past. I mean, in the past in Egypt, they would, the parliament, the prime minister would appoint his cabinet, and he would present a policy program to the parliament, and they would approve it, and sometimes they would argue about it and so forth. But it didn't tend to go much further than that. So I think that's something that's going to change. Now, one of the things that we don't know, and I'd be very interested to hear what Sahar and Samer have to say about this as well, is whether the new constitution is going to be written before or after there is a new president. There have been a lot of different views. This has been very controversial in Egypt. Sort of the preponderance of opinion for a long time was that the new constitution would be written and approved by popular referendum before the president was elected. But there isn't much time at this point. Now, you might have followed over the weekend this very lively and controversial process within the Egyptian parliament of choosing a 100-member constituent assembly. They've now done this after just a pretty quick process, really just kind of a couple of weeks of looking at candidates and so forth, and people voted and they announced the results. So there is now this 100-member constituent assembly, but it's falling apart as quickly as it was formed. It is dominated by Islamists. I believe it's about 60% are Islamists. Half of it are people who are parliamentarians, who were elected from within the parliament, and the other half are so-called public figures. And throughout the whole elections process, people knew that this was coming, and the Brotherhood was at pains to say that they would be sure that social forces and political forces were fairly represented. But what people are now saying today in Egypt is that didn't happen. Because if you start to look at the numbers, I mean, for example, women are, there are six women out of 100 members of the Constituent Assembly. There are six Coptic Christians, and two of those are overlapped. So between women and Christians, you've got a total of 10. And in fact, two of the women are Muslim Brotherhood women. So the number of liberal or leftist figures is very small, and in fact, they've been resigning over the last 24 hours and saying, well, we refuse to be part of this thing if we're not going to be fairly represented. And Samer and I were just talking, there is a process for, there is a backup list of 40 figures or whatever who can replace them. But I do think it starts to call into question the credibility of the assembly. You know, it becomes, I mean, they might technically be able to be replaced, but I think it could actually become a bit of a problem for the Islamists if others start resigning. So we'll see. This is a very dynamic process right now, today, as to how many people are going to stick with this constituent assembly. There are, of course, drafts of the new constitution around, but to think that they are going to approve a draft and put it up for a popular referendum either before or at the same time as the presidential election, which begins on May 23rd. I wouldn't say it's impossible. I think it seems unlikely to me, and certainly unwise. Yeah, I'm reading your lips, Sahar. Certainly very unwise, I think. So that's the situation. So what that means then is if you do end up having a if you do end up having a presidential election before the parliamentary election, then that raises the question of someone being elected without a clear picture of what his powers will be. And so that's, you know, that raises a lot of questions for, you know, what, how much will this mean and so forth. We also really don't know what the relationship of this president will be to the major political forces in the country, to the military and the other old regime forces, to the Islamists, the various Islamist forces, because as you heard from Summer, the Islamists are not necessarily, you know, all together on this. And of course, that can make a huge difference. We don't know who's going to be elected, and we don't know, there are, it seems that both the military leadership and the Brotherhood leadership have been struggling trying to define whom they want to support. I mean, I think their big problem was that, you know, Samer identified for you the leading two candidates, Amr Moussa and Abul Futuh, and it seemed that neither the Brotherhood nor the SCAF was happy with them. You know, it's possible that maybe the military would make its peace with Amr Moussa, but there's been speculation that he's too independent a figure for them, and they might have some other objections to him. And Abul Futuh, as Samer told you, left the Brotherhood, and there seems to be a bit of a difference between the Brotherhood leadership that doesn't feel that kind of a break can be forgiven, and the Brotherhood rank and file, who many of whom like Abul Futuh and want to support him. So, you know, we have until April 10th, I believe, for all of these candidates to submit. Now, we're hearing now that Omar Suleiman, the former head of intelligence, maybe registering a candidacy, has collected the signatures and so forth. So I think, you know, right now we really don't know if the military and the Brotherhood are going to support specific candidates. It's very hard to predict the outcome not knowing that. We also don't know, and Samer began to talk about this, how free and fair these elections are going to be. Sahara already spoke of this concern about the lack of a right of appeal because of the powers given to the Presidential Election Commission in the interim constitution. That's been something roiling inside of Egypt. People are very worried about that. Because they think it could provide the current leadership a way to control the outcome. And as you know, this crisis of NGOs, of Egyptian and foreign NGOs who were deeply involved in monitoring the parliamentary elections, goes on. And many of these NGOs are now, some of them are, you know, actively under prosecution or closed down. Others are fearful and on the defensive. And there's even some speculation that was what was behind the whole NGO crisis, was making sure they wouldn't be there to monitor the presidential election. I don't know if that's true, but so there are, you know, there are some concerns about how well this election will be run. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Now, what we've got now is some time for question and answer. I think that what I'm going to do is ask, maybe given that we've got a long room, we won't use the mic unless people in the back have difficulty hearing. But I think I may ask when you're talking, or ask our panelists to stand up, so that we can project. And I would ask people who are asking questions to ask questions, and maybe to identify yourself, so that we can then have some further enlightenment from our panel. So does anybody want anybody there? Yeah, blue shirt.
Oh, sorry. Okay, Daniel, Conflict Resolution Program. So it seems that. Could you speak more about the internal processes by which the parties come up with their candidates. I'm sure it's different in the United States. And also, if you think that needs to change. And it's just my impression that their internal processes kind of incentivize these parties to come up with consensus candidates. And what do you think about that?
Okay, you're targeting
Sommer,
why don't we take notes. Let's take two or three, and then people can talk. Yes, in the back.
Hi, my name's Gerald with the Security Space Program. I was just wondering what the potential you think there is for similar type of violence that we've seen prior to the legislative elections, whether it's, you know, the SCAP initiating some decree that creates protests and then, you know, produces violence or, you know, something like that again.
We've got consensus and violence. Okay,
right. Abraham Oase, former professor in Georgetown. I have a very difficult question.
Okay,
with all the intricacies of the current problems in Egypt, I just was wondering if I can bring to the attention to the great minds that are here. The question is, what would be the directions Egypt would take in the future? And this may be subject of an article that Thomas Kurgisyan can write about, Khalid Majindi, or others, but we are all concerned. I represent the past, but I'm still looking forward for the future.
And then we'll take one last question in the back there, and then we'll get.
Okay. We talked, I think, extensively about the internal problems in Egypt, you know, from economic and political and security, you know, standpoints. But, you know, as we are, you know, outlining all these candidates, you know, I wonder if it's possible to shed some light on how the international community, you know, perceive those candidates and what kind of effect, you know, those candidates will have in the future to stabilize the region and Egypt and be able to march forward economically and politically, you know, with less issues.
Okay, I think now we've got 3 15-minute speeches, let me just go through the order. Sahar and Samer and Michelle, in responding, I think this gives us a very good basis for thinking about the current complexities in international and what really is the future. Okay, Sahar.
Well,
why don't you stand
really,
up?
Oh, these are really challenging questions. So I approach this as a formalist rule of law lawyer, so you'll have to excuse these responses are not as political analyst responses. But I actually care more about the next election than I do this one, because that's going to determine if Egypt is no longer going to be ruled by an authoritarian and a dictator, whether they're Islamist or secularist or military sponsored. I think this election matters in how many people turn out to vote, how many people care, how much discussion and debate there is. I think, I don't know who in their right mind would want this job. I think it's literally set up to fail. And perhaps that's why sometimes I think maybe it's better than someone that older takes it and they just kind of lay the groundwork for the next person. So that's not, you know, not a crystal ball response, but I think it's the second election. I'm focused on the structure. So another comment or response is, what was really encouraging for me when I went to Egypt in March right after the revolution in the summer is the shift in people's engagement. You know, people were talking about politics. They felt empowered. They felt they had a say, even if they didn't like the outcome. That is a tremendous change in culture and in practice. And that, to me, is much more important than whether the appointee took over the parliament or not. As long as the people will remove them, and can remove them if they don't follow through. And it sends a message to the appointee or whoever's ruling that we're watching you and we're going to remove you. Now, is this the question about the role of the West? So I take a bit of a skeptical approach. I accept the premise that the United States plays a significant role in Egyptian politics. I accept that premise, and I realize people may disagree. I think that what happened with the NGO prosecutions and the way that
you know, lo and behold, right after McCain went to visit, everyone was allowed to leave the country, shows that we had quite a bit of influence. Now, I take issue with the way that, the Egyptian government handled the NGO prosecutions, and I think they were highly politicized. But the point is, the United States plays a role. The United States influences the SCAP, if only because we give them $1.3 million, if not more. So I think that to the extent the SCAP has any influence over who's going to be president, they are definitely going to be thinking about whether the United States would approve or not create problems. I think the Muslim Brotherhood thinks the same thing, because the Muslim Brotherhood doesn't want to be treated like Hamas. They don't want to be marginalized. They don't want to be designated as a terrorist organization. Not that I think we could get away with that. I think they're a little bit too powerful now. But they don't want Egypt to suffer because of that, which is why I think they never wanted to put up a presidential candidate in the first place, at least claim country. So I do think that I think about that when I think about who's the candidate going to be, to the extent the SCAP has influence, to the extent the Muslim Brotherhood does.
Sorry. Okay. Sure. Just very briefly, with regard to the internal processes of how parties come up with candidates, well, that's somewhat mysterious. The point that's important to know, however, is that under the current system, parties that have representation in Parliament are allowed to circumvent the 30,000 signatures of the general public or 30 members of Parliament. They can actually put someone in front of the electorate as a candidate automatically. And we're going to see a number of smaller parties that have absolutely no chance whatsoever. The Popular Socialist Party and the Egyptian National Party put forward candidates that aren't going to do very well. The more interesting question is bigger parties that have, you know, bigger is relative, like the WEFT, for example, or the WASAP parties. We've seen some internal debates already as to who they are going to support, not nominate, but support. So, for example, the WEFT had previously said they were going to support Amr Moussa. And then when Mansour Hassan was put forward, they had this debate about, no, well, maybe we should support Mansour Hassan, right, and so on. And in fact, there were some divisions inside the WEFT about that. The WASAP party also has had some debates as to which of the Islamist candidates they're going to support. And in fact, recently, in the last week or so, there has been speculation in Egyptian press that they are trying to get one of the Islamist candidates, not Hezbollah Ismail, but either Mohammed Salim al-Awla or Abdul Minim Abu Futuh, to withdraw his candidacy so there can be one moderate or liberal Islamist candidate that they can put their money behind. And that's interesting. We've already seen Mohammed Salim al-Awla say he's not backing down. But I think he actually is the much weaker candidate compared to Abdul Minim al-Futuh for a number of reasons. He's got no real support base. And then, of course, you know, the speculation of the FJP, the Freedom and Justice Party, if they put forward someone, then that's interesting. The other thing I will say, and I can't answer all the questions, is Professor Oase's interesting question about the future and so on. Well, I think if we look at two dimensions, I will, you know, with some empirical evidence here, I will crib from the excellent work of the Gallup organization to provide you with some empirical evidence. I think that if we look at economics, for example, and then say Egypt's foreign relations, particularly with the US and Israel, we can make out some general directions, right? I think with the economic policy, we're likely to see something significantly different than what we saw in the previous period. Remember, between 2004 and the revolution, we saw vigorous implementation of neoliberal economic policies, meaning unprecedented number of privatizations, subsidy cuts, deregulation, inviting foreign capital in, and so on. Remember, the revolution, one of the leading slogans was, right? So bread, freedom, and social justice. There have been already demands for new minimum wages, as well as a maximum wage on government officials, and so on. Demands, there have been, you know, hundreds and hundreds of labor protests. So although we're not likely to see a return to nationalization and so on, we are not definitely going to see the kind of, you know, vigorous ideological pursuit of neoliberal economic policies. Then with regard to Egypt's foreign policy, I think it's also fair to say that the days of
the previous U.S.-Egyptian relationship, as well as the relatively good relationship that the Mubarak regime had with Israel, are over, right? We are going to see a decline or deterioration, I would say declining influence of the U.S. with regard to Egypt. There's no question about that. Egypt, the U.S. had a relationship with Mr. Mubarak, right? We know that U.S. policy is not looked upon favorably by the majority of Egyptians. And in fact, and this is where I'm going to crib from the excellent work of Muhammad here in the audience in Gallup, is we look at, you know, which country would you consider to be a political model for Egypt's future? This is a recent Gallup poll. The United States is the lowest compared with Turkey or Saudi Arabia. Only 8% of Egyptians say they want to see the U.S. as a model. And then when the question is asked, you know, do you want, the question is, are closer ties with a country, blank, left, a good or bad thing for Egypt? The United States is deteriorating. Only 28% of the people say closer ties are a good thing. 56% say they are a bad thing, and that is a decrease of 13 points since December 2001. Any government that is representative of Egyptians will have to some extent, reflect their views. And that means, it might mean something like no longer natural gas sales to Israel, or renegotiating that, or a different relationship with the United States. Now, the majority of Egyptians don't want to tear up the Camp David peace accords, and they don't want antagonistic relationship with the United States. But will the relationships be as strong and so on? Will the U.S. have as much influence on Egypt and its regional and foreign policy? I don't think so.
Okay, let's see. I'll try to hit maybe a couple of the questions that were not. So Joe's question about the potential for violence. Typically in the past, it's been parliamentary elections in Egypt that have tended to be more violent, you know, because of local conflicts, you know, with support, you know, a lot of different races, hundreds of different races going on at the same time, and supporters of candidates, and sometimes supporters that had different, you know, clan affiliations or whatever, coming into conflict with each other. So we really don't know, but I would say, you know, this whole question of if there's controversy, Sarah mentioned this, if there's controversy about the outcome of the presidential election, that could get violent, you know, and I think a runoff will definitely bring the tension up, and especially if at the end of the day you're having a runoff against what seemed to be a military-supported and an Islamist-supported candidate, you know, I mean, it could get ugly, so we'll have to see there. And just briefly to Dr. Oase's question, what will be the direction Egypt will take in the future? You know, I think that Egypt has been for some time and will continue to be for a long time yet in the throes of kind of a struggle among at least three different trends. You know, kind of what I would call, in a way, the Nasserist trend, the trend of the old regime that, and Islamist trend, and a much weaker liberal trend. But it's very weak, but it's stronger than it used to be, I think. And I think that, you know, it's just going to play itself out, and it's not going to be resolved, I would say, for years yet.
Okay, well, I'll take about three more questions, because we should probably be out of here by noon. So let's do. We haven't had yes, we haven't had a lady ask for this.
Of the viability the Constitution will have and the powers that the President will have, what do you think the odds are that the President will be able to effectively govern? And the other question is, given that Egyptians want a new system, it's very clear that the authoritarian system, very strong presidential system, is not favorable in Egypt. What are the odds that with this series of events, we will be able to change the system? How will the parliament be able to assert itself if you're given a president before you have a constitution?
And let me just do sort of, at the very end, there are two, you and then the person behind you.
I have two questions. One of
Quick.
Them will take a one word. Are you optimistic or pessimistic about the future of transition in Egypt? I think think that I'd like to have one, maybe two words. I don't know. But I'd like to get some kind of a feel from you folks, three of you. The other question, we heard about 500 or hundreds of people running for president. There is so much, even the Muslim Brotherhood is divided. I know Samer didn't want to talk about coalition and collaboration. And from my experience, I'm Egyptian American, my experience is a very difficult subject for Americans, either in politics or military or even in sport, to collaborate. How this collaboration, any collaboration you can comment on or happy? And then.
You touched on this, the minority participation, especially the Copts. I would ask, especially with the Pope's death just 10 days ago, how do you see, what's the repercussion of the death? Because the Pope was a very much a unifying force in Egypt for the Copts, and beginning the revolution, he was very supportive of the Mubarak regime, and he went actually and told people, the Christians, not to go to Tahrir because we're supportive of Mubarak. So now, after his death, his replacement is a completely different issue. I don't want to get into that. But what do you see the Copts going after as a unified force and supporting Abu Fatah as a candidate because of his ideologies, or being divided and going for different parties, give even to Muslim Brotherhood candidates if they were to participate?
Okay, we're talking about a democratic system. But in this room, we are authoritarian, and so that there'll be one last question in each. And then you can do quickie summaries.
Thanks. Question about the Muslim Brotherhood youth in particular, and how you see that dynamic formulating with the current party and supporting Fatah. Also, where you see the current party allying itself, if it'll continue with the revolution, continue to flop or move to the Third Way Alliance, but particularly who are the emerging young leaders and actors that you're following?
I think this gives us a good agenda for each of you to do a couple-minute quickie wrap-up.
So I think the answer to the presidential versus parliamentary system, which is a big question of whether it's going to change from the status quo or not. So I tend to think, and I have the same analysis in the United States, is those in power seek to keep power and seek to perpetuate their power. So the Muslim Brotherhood just picked 50 of the constitutional, at least 50 of them are theirs, or are 60%, it seems. So they're probably going to create a constitution that gives more power to the parliament, because at this moment in time, that would help them continue to stay in power. So I think that might be something to watch for. I don't know if they're going to be thinking about it more from an abstract rule of law perspective of, well, what's better for the country in the long run, let's look at this country versus that country. I think politicians think about their own self-interest, wherever they are, in whatever country. So they're going to say, well, let's have a constitution that keeps us in power. Now, it'll be interesting if the president gets elected. I think the constitutional referendum act after the elections, because I just think it's physically impossible. I don't know if that's what they want, but so I think the president's already going to be in place. So it'll be very fascinating if the president ends up being someone that the Akhwan approve of, or actually participated in putting it in place, because then they're going to be in an interesting position where they may not want to take so much power from the president, because he may help them continue to dominate the political system. So, and I don't say that as a critique to the Muslim Brotherhood, but that's just my view of power and politics. As far as the Coptics, I think that's a really interesting question. So one thing I didn't mention in my presentation is there was a discussion about quotas for Copts when they were talking about quotas for women. They decided against it because, one, Pope Shenouda didn't want it, because he was afraid it would create a backlash, sectarian backlash. And as you know, Pope Shenouda had a very close relationship with Mubarak, and it was really a relationship of self-interest. Of, you know, he wanted to protect the Popes. He was very patronizing and, you know, very Egyptian. And I've heard, and this is anecdotal, and I'm admittedly not Coptic, that Pope Shenouda also, there was a lot of differences within the Coptic community that kind of got pushed and marginalized under unity as a minority. And that happens in many minority communities around the world. So what will be interesting is how the Coptic community's natural divisions between the liberals, the progressives, the conservatives, you know, the natural divisions that happen in Egyptian society, how are they going to now play out without Pope Shenouda? Because whoever's going to be the leader now needs to get along at least with the Muslim Brotherhood. Or who knows who? I mean, it's so unstable. So I don't know the answer. I think it's fascinating. I do have heard a lot of concern, though, about the Islamists. And I don't know if it's based on fact or fiction, like just fear, but there's definitely concern of if the Islamists come, the Copts are doomed. And I don't necessarily agree with that, but that's a concern.
Sure. I mean, you know, they're very good and very difficult questions, and because there are three of us here, I'm going to escape from answering the most difficult ones. But I will
we'll leave that for Michelle.
I will, you know, respond to this idea of coalitions and collaborations. I think it's an interesting question, and I think that if we actually look at Abdelmanab el-Fattouh's base as well as some of the individuals and groups that are now joining him as a viable presidential candidate, we do see coalitions and collaboration. It is amazing to think that, for example, now he's appointed Rabab al-Mahdi, right, who's a professor at the American University in Cairo, political science, from the Revolutionary Socialists, right, as one of his political advisors. And he also now has the support of Wael Khalil, another revolutionary socialist, and so on. And also, as I mentioned, some segments of the Egyptian liberal population, if we can call it that. In addition, unlike many of the other candidates, Amr Musa and so on, he does represent a concern with social justice issues, right? These issues that have to deal with health for poor people or moderate income people, education, and so on. So I think that we do see potentially a coalition, you know, a wider coalition supporting him than any of the other candidates. And I think just the one word answer to the optimistic or pessimistic, it's kind of a way out, but kind of pessimistic and confused in the short term, but I think optimistic in the medium and long term.
And Michelle, you have our last word.
Okay. Yeah, Ibrahim, I'm sort of the same way. I would say I'm optimistic over 15 years. And I'm pessimistic over the next 5 years. Okay, I'm going to make it a little bit more precise about what's going to happen in Egypt. Look, the odds that the new president will be able to govern effectively, you know, it's going to be tough. I mean, it's certainly not going to be the way it has been, you know, in Egypt for a long time, because either, you know, there's no consensus candidate, as Samer said. So at this point, it seems that whoever's elected is either going to not have the support of the military or not have the support of parliament. So it's going to be, you know, it's not going to be easy. But of course, you know, this person is going to have a popular mandate, you know, and I think that's going to give the person a little bit more more of a boost, you know, in terms of being able to get some things done. Regarding the question of Christians and the implications of the death of the Pope, so it seems that it's going to take some months, at least, for a new Pope to be named. This is not something that's going to happen overnight. But I would say that, at any rate, we had seen the sort of discipline or political discipline of the church over the Coptic Christian community had broken down to a large degree anyway, you know, and I mean, if you look back to 2005 or whatever, you know, the Pope was just telling Copts how to vote, you know, and that clearly was no longer possible even within the last year or so. The good news there, of course, is that Coptic Christians have become so much more politically active, and they are becoming active, you know, in a number of different parties and so forth. I mean, the Free Egyptians, unless the name al-Ahrar, probably has the most Coptic Christians involved in it, but not by no means only. I mean, I think other leftist liberals, etc., as we all know, there's even a Christian in a major position in the Freedom and Justice Party and so forth, although that's a bit of a fig leaf. But at any rate, I would say that, you know, I'm not sure that the death of the Pope will make that much of a difference, that this diversity and people putting out their political support to different candidates had already started to happen.
Okay, well, thank you. The three of you, we're very grateful. I apologize for my authoritarianness. If you want to protest, go out to Red Square.
Thank you.